Good afternoon. Thank you all for finding time and visiting today's webinar. First of all, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Dr. Oksana Chorna, and I'm Associate Professor of Finance and Modern College of Business and Science, and I will be the moderator today. Before we start, let me explain how you can talk to us during the webinar. If you have any questions during the presentation, just write them to question and answer area. We will have question and answer area session at the end and answer it. We will send you all the relevant links after the event, including the link to the webinar recording. Now we can begin. On behalf of our organizer, I would like to extend my warm welcome to the all guests of MCBS Chronic Series, a weekly webinar series covering various topics in English and Arabic. Please let me a special welcome our distinguished guest, Professor of Krakow University of Technology, Dr. Jacek Leskov, who kindly agreed to deliver this seminar. Our topic today is Internet of Things, Artificial Intelligence, Big Data, and Teaching Statistics. I am honored to briefly tell you about this amazing person and his valuable contribution to develop new prediction algorithm for the time series and signals. He has been principal investigator of research project from NATA, director of statistical consulting lab in the University of California, leader of project of creating the National Institute of Data Science sponsored by the National Center of Research and Development in Poland. He prepared 5 research books published by Springer, 62 publications in international journals, and since 2000 was a leader of international research group. He has headed the Ministry of Digitalization group, developed the strategy of artificial intelligence for Poland, and provided the development of our application of artificial intelligence tools into the nationwide public administration platform. During the last 2 years, he has been director of National Research Institute in Warsaw and created and chaired the program of in data science at the Krakow University of Technology. He speaks fluently 6 languages: English, French, Spanish, Russian, Portuguese, and of course, Polish. And he has worked in the United States, Poland, Mexico, Brazil, France, Ukraine, and Kyrgyzstan. I want to express my gratitude that he agreed to take part in our seminar. Now, Dr. Jacek Leskov, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So I understand I can start sharing the screen. Is that okay? So anyway, before I start sharing the screen, well, maybe I can do it already now. Let's check the connection. Yeah, this is the front page of my talk. I hope you can see the front page of the talk. Is everything okay?
Yes, we can see.
Very good. So let me start my talk. First of all, it is a real honor to be invited by Dr. Chorna, who was too modest not to mention that she was my collaborator in Poland. And I'm glad she has found right now an excellent career in a very prestigious College of Business and Science in Muscat, Oman. It is definitely my first time to have any interaction with Oman, and I'm really very pleased to have this invitation. But what was not mentioned in the introduction regarding my career, this is definitely not my first time to have a research scientific interaction with the Arabic world. Within the research topics that I was involved to, and the research projects, for example, funded by NATO, I have found collaborators from other Arabic countries. I have a collaborator from King Abdullah University of Science and Technology in Saudi Arabia. I have co-authored books with a faculty member of Sfax University in Tunisia. And I have supervised PhD students coming from French-speaking Arabic countries like Morocco, Algeria, and Mali. So I can see this opportunity as an excellent possibility to continue my very fruitful so far interaction with the Arabic world. And again, I'm extremely thankful for the invitation. I had the opportunity just a few seconds ago to watch the information material prepared by the university regarding the range of activities you have. And this is really, really very impressive. And I was extremely pleased to see computer science and statistics among the topics that you are involved, which makes my talk will be a mix of my management experience with the digital technology and also experience from the point of view of a teacher with the digital technology. So I really hope, you know, this is just a beginning of a maybe longer term cooperation. And I was already exchanging some ideas with Dr. Czorna via email regarding possible mutual contacts between students of your college and my university in Krakow. And well, you know, possibility to actually exchange the experiences. I would like maybe to append a little bit my background presentation regarding the artificial intelligence. I think the very fundamental research project that I was involved with the colleagues from the University of California, from other United States universities and stuff from European centers are signals. I'm going to actually present you some signals and how we process those signals today. And when we are talking, because I understand many people in the audience may not necessarily be very familiar with nitty-gritty details of statistics. When we talk about the Internet of Things, when we talk about artificial intelligence and big data, we are really processing fundamental three types of streams of information. Those are the signals, like the audio signal, the visual signals, the video. And these days, we are also able to process speech, text, in order to have the automatic inferential machines. So whatever we call artificial intelligence is based on signals. I was able to apply expertise I was developing with my friends to many areas of day-to-day life. For example, risk management. There is no risk management, there is no advanced financial econometrics without a good knowledge of artificial intelligence. Well, it is obvious that when you are entering any dealership of a bank who is providing you the investment opportunities on the markets, everything is based on signals generated by companies who are trading. When we are talking about operations management or project management, of course, you are doing optimization, and optimization is a part also of numerical routines and statistics. So essentially speaking, when someone is asking why any college, like your college, the Modern College of Business and Science, or my college, Politechnika Krakowska, which is Krakow Technical University, why we are teaching statistics? It is because it has fundamental impact on the decisions we are making. Well, before I will move to do the technical presentation, let me also tell you, let me take this opportunity to advertise my hometown, which is Krakow. Krakow is one of the most beautiful historical towns in Central Europe. Well, before the pandemic, Krakow was visited annually by more than 4 million tourists. In our town, we have about 1 million inhabitants, out of which 200,000 are students. It's a very lively, very historical town with lots of opportunities for students. We have many excellent schools, one of the oldest universities in Europe, the second in the range of the age, the second oldest university of Europe is exactly located in Krakow. Krakow is also a bustling center of modern technology. In my classes of artificial intelligence, big data and statistics, I am frequently inviting people from large international corporations like IBM or Nokia, who are very willingly coming to class to have interactions with students. Only recently, I got an email from international headquarters of IBM. They seek students with advanced degree in mathematics and statistics to do optimization routines for IBM. And also we are actually coming with students to the IBM local in Krakow to learn more about the development of artificial intelligence and statistics. So you see, Krakow is a very good place. And I'm sure our experiences will be so much more richer if we can also expand our contacts to countries like Oman and learn how you are dealing with the current revolution in digital world, what are your experiences, and to have a good interaction. So essentially speaking, I'm moving right now to the technical part of my presentation, and let me start with a very, very general view on what is happening right now in the recent 2 years, essentially. What is going on with our world? What is the digital civilization all about? What I'm going to tell you right now is essentially based both on my research expertise and also on my expertise as a director of a nationwide institute that works with security of the systems, cybersecurity, the civilian sector of internet. It's supervised by NASC. You see the logo of institution and the left bottom corner of the transparency. And this institute is actually having a very good perspective on what's going on in cybersecurity, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, and big data. Let's start a little bit with the security issues. Well, you know, in the digital world, in the digital civilization, everything is connected. We have really to rethink fundamental concepts around which our societies are built. For example, a concept of property. Well, 250 years ago, when modern countries were established, for example, like United States or France, the fundamental element of property was a real estate. Well, of course, real estate these days is also very important, but there is a new emerging quantum of the property, which is obviously data. So we have to be very, very careful these days when we create informative systems that are functioning in digital civilization in order to know exactly what is happening with the data, who is arranging the data collection system, what kind of designs are for the data, who is making decisions based on the data, and hey, also who is profiting from these decisions. In the European Union, we are extremely sensitive to the question of the security of systems. We have identified so-called critical infrastructures for the public administration, that is the government administration, the local administration, and the industrial networks. An institution like NASC, and I'm sure in Oman probably you have a similar institution that oversees the civilian sector of your internet and is trying to monitor and prevent attacks, you also observe signals. So cybersecurity is also a signal observation, a signal collection. Then you are building some certain measures. Let me give you an example. What kind of a cyber attack a year ago have occurred in Poland? It wasn't like a nationwide paralysis, but it was a very correlated attack to two public institutions in relatively small towns. And this attack, first of all, has stolen the data regarding the population in those towns. And some of the data, of course, are very sensitive, like your social security number, your national ID number, and so on, your age, and possibly also some history of your work and well-being. On the top of it, such attacks can actually create what is known as denial of service. What is denial of service? Denial of service simply is when lots of works, lots of jobs are flowing to your computer, and then your processor or your server is paralyzed because it cannot process too many works, and that's how the denial of service is created. So every country and every institution that has extensive information system has to have vaccines against such viruses. And one of the vaccines developed at NASC was the anti-denial of service system that provides a certain shield against those attacks. But of course, the story of cyber attacks is never ending. Once one shield is invented, another type of attacks is executed. So there should be constant monitoring and improving the quality of the security systems. In European Union, we have an organization, the European-wide organization that is called ENISA, that provides norms. And probably those of you who work with quality control are familiar with the ISO norms. There is a collection of norms, ISO 27000, that stipulates exactly what kind of steps an organization has to take in order to call this organization a cyber secure organization. From the point of a statistician, because you know the main topic of my talk is not, of course, cybersecurity and cyber secure systems, but teaching statistics in the modern world of digital civilization. So I am looking at the cybersecurity issue from a perspective of a statistician. We would like, first of all, to have protection of the data. We would like to know exactly who is collecting the data. We would like to know what kind of mechanism of data processing are used in order to provide certain solutions or decisions. And this has to be standardized and certified. Let me give you a practical example. And maybe during the discussion, I can learn more about your problems with telecommunication. What is right now looming behind horizon in Europe is 5G technology. And I'm sure also in Oman you heard about 5G. You may already have some base stations and you may have a system that is getting ready for the 5G revolution. 5G essentially is the digital platform that is enabling things, well, machines, to share data in an automated manner and then reach certain decisions. Well, an extremely simple example, of course, is the autonomous car, a car without a driver that has all the sensors possible. And with the quick signals that are available in the 5G technology, a car can, for example, come to the intersection, recognize the signs, and then do, well, either stop at the red light or go forward at the green light, right? We know very well as statisticians, and I know very well as a person who spent last 40 years of my life doing signal processing, how easy it is to corrupt decision systems that are based on image analysis, for example. There is we were studying special form of attacks on the information systems in the 5G technology that are available in autonomous cars, where a system that works with 95% efficiency that is able to read the road signs, after a short attack is having only 50% of efficiency. It's reading the stop sign as the sign 30 miles per hour. If anyone who is listening to this talk is a driver, this is a fundamental flaw. If you read a sign who says stop, if you read this sign as a 30 miles per hour sign. So there should be a set of standards. When we are talking about information security, I hope the white arrow is visible. Can you see the white arrow that is moving around the screen? Well, maybe not. So what I'm doing right now, I'm finishing the section on network and information security. And I'm talking about standardization and certification. So there is a very big need these days to standardize and certify all the solutions that are using the 5G IoT technology that process big data. Well, when we are talking 5G technology, we have the huge quantum of data flowing automatically between machines and making decisions. So we need to certify this process. Okay, let me move to other issues that are fundamental with the our modern digital civilization, because first I would like to spend some time discussing with you, presenting the basic issues of the modern digital civilization. And on the basis of this observation, I would like to tell you more about how we really need to teach statistics these days. For example, image analysis. In medicine, it is quite possible these days to have the biometric sensors, to have the systems that are enabling us to pass the information from the doctor's consultory office to the operation room. And we are definitely able these days to run complicated medical operations in places where no highly qualified personnel is available, because there are robots that are available, and there are also very fast internet connections using the image analysis that is enabling us to process the data and run the operations. So you see, the digital civilization has this excellent advantage that when you are moving away from the highly urbanized area, with the help of the computer systems, we can run image analysis. Is there a question?
Sorry, yes, doctor. I think your slide stuck. Could you please reload this? Because that's okay. Just reflect on the first one.
So you want me to exit the screen sharing and do it again, right?
Yeah, you can like the escape and the yes. Share again.
Let me do that right away. Okay. Yes, can you see my slides right now?
Yes, I can.
Very good, I'm glad. So let me know if there is any problem. Okay. I'll be happy to do
it. Yes.
No problem. So again, the coming back to my topic, the image analysis, signal processing, making decisions, benefit to the patient. With the modern digital civilization, we are able to run operations at remote posts where no qualified personnel or no people who are specialists are available, with the help of robots and image analysis machines who are able, after the diagnosis is done, to do the operation. This is a major advancement in, for example, access to medicine. And well, especially in the times of COVID, we know very well the stress that is put on the medical sector of any country, because we have to take care of the sick and ailing patients. I'm now trying to move closer and closer to teaching statistics issue. Well, when we are in the classroom, or we have these days classes via internet with students, most of my students are computer science students, and I was very happy also to find that computer science is taught at your college. And computer science students these days are extremely knowledgeable about systems that do machine learning, deep learning, the pattern recognition, which is the part of the image analysis. You can now harvest the social networks in order to reach certain, well, market decisions after, well, observing the mood, so to speak, on the social network. Well, as a statistician, I see machine learning and deep learning as a very useful tool, but many times those algorithms are providing only partial solutions. That is, we don't see a very clear connection between, there is no cause-effect relationship when we let the machine analyze millions of data and then only say, okay, well, for example, the forecast is so-and-so, or this patient is healthy or sick. We would like to have explainable artificial intelligence. And in Poland, for example, a group of statisticians who are also knowledgeable in artificial intelligence is starting right now research in XAI, which is explainable artificial intelligence. And what I'm going to tell you right now is a part of this explainable artificial intelligence. So what I'm doing right now, I'm moving to the next page of my presentation. Okay, can you see a runner? Can you see a person running?
So yes, from a very general... Yeah, we can see.
Yes, from a very, very general, let's say, perspective of the opportunities and challenges and dangers of the digital civilization, I'm moving to a very, very practical example. An example I was involved with my research colleagues from France, with also PhD students from Tunisia and Algeria. What is the purpose of the study? You can see a person that is running, and every now and then you see like a green line, and this is a stress line. On the treadmill, we have many sensors, and below the running person, you see curves. Those curves explain the ground reaction force. So this is like a force that is measured by left and by the right foot. On the basis of measuring this signal, we were able to produce a diagnostic system helping the doctors to actually see a forthcoming Alzheimer's disease. You may wonder, what is the relationship between a seemingly extremely healthy and nice-looking young fellow who is running and a person who may have Alzheimer's disease? Usually Alzheimer's disease is a disease of my age group. I am now almost 61. What is the relationship? Well, the signals, ground reaction force, that are produced by this treadmill can be analyzed, and then we can produce special features. I'm going to talk about those features later on. And then after those features are identified and measured, we can ask a person from my age group, not necessarily to run as beautifully as this young chap, but just to have a, you know, moderate speed walk on the treadmill and to check what is the situation with our balance, because one of the early symptoms of Alzheimer's disease is the lack of synchronization that can be observed when you walk. If you walk in a very measured and synchronous way, you are healthy. If this is not so, then you might be at higher risk, given that you are in the risk group, given that you are in the age group 60 and above. So from this observation, we are moving to a little bit more concrete thing. That is, we are moving to the signal. What you are seeing in front of your eyes is the signal collected in this treadmill. This signal is already centered because the center of the signal is zero, because we are interested in anomalies. We are interested in those spikes in the signal. And now the big data question comes, because this signal is observed with the frequency of about 2 kilohertz. 2 kilohertz means 2000 data points per second. If you ask someone to walk on a treadmill for 15 minutes, which is the usual exercise, this person is producing, if not millions, then at least hundreds of thousands of data points. Then how to process those points? Because the endpoint, the sort of a goal of the study, is to tell whether this person is sick or healthy, whether any chances of Alzheimer's coming is there. So you need to do some processing. And do you see this colorful picture? Is there any problem of seeing this?
Yes,
because it has some structure. So now I'm talking from the perspective of the teacher, okay? I'm trying to present a complicated issue to the students of, for example, signal processing class or time series class. And this difficult concept is the autocovariance. If I will start with a very general formula, dry straight from some theoretical book, students after 5 minutes will sleep from the boredom. They will not understand. But if I will tell them that this, maybe using some oriental comparison, maybe this can be compared to the flying carpet with lots of sort of waves, and you can collect, you can connect the height of those waves and the place where they are with the characteristic features of the signal. You see, coloring here comes from a very famous program, which is MATLAB. So we are in the automatic way passing the signal to the MATLAB algorithm that we have developed. We are producing this first measure of, let's say, characteristic feature of the signal, and we are checking to those students who are maybe more familiar with math, the alpha corresponds to the frequency, and we are looking for frequencies that are characteristics for the signal. And in this way, we are associating a little bit difficult statistical and mathematical concept with the very practical issue. And also, you see, instead of working with hundreds of thousands of numbers, you are working with a beautifully looking surface, and you are checking, at least at the first glance, you can do a visual inspection, how the autocovariance looks like. Okay, so that's from the data to the feature, and in this case, this feature is autocovariance, and then to the frequency, and then to the diagnosis. There is a sequence. There is an advanced technical part in that, which, well, I'm happy to tell you that I have developed. Of course, I'm not going to bore you to death right now with technical details, but in order to better your scientific decisions based on data, many resampling algorithms are used these days. And one of the resampling algorithms that I was heavily involved with is called Bootstrap. And we have the frequency signature. Okay. On this picture, you see a bunch of red lines. And one red line is definitely different from the others. Well, if the red line doesn't intersect the horizontal black line, this means that we have identified a frequency. So now I can even with this tell to my students, listen, there is an advanced procedure like a bootstrap, and this serves to identify the frequency, and we have this important information about the signal. So you see, teaching statistics these days, it should be different. I think we should start from realistic, modern day big data examples that involve, for example, signals of time series, very complicated data structures, much more complicated than just some independent observations. And then on this data, you teach people, you teach students or your partners how to identify a feature, what are the particular parts of the feature identification, what is the technique behind it, and then what you are getting at the beginning. So in order to summarize the first example of the runner, the frequency signature, well, can tell us with 95% efficiency whether a person is sick or healthy with respect to Alzheimer. You know that all the tests, especially now we are doing many tests for the presence of COVID, any test is only as good as the false positive and the false negatives are low. You need to really work on it very, very carefully. And again, statistics is very, very helpful. Now, what is the cost of the study? With the big data these days, in the United States and the European Union, there are hundreds of thousands of people who wear on the daily basis smartwatch. And the smartwatch is actually doing the signal analysis in the online way. Well, let's say with the frequency 2 kHz, your blood pressure, exactly the ground reaction force, any other movement can be analyzed. And if you sign a contract with your insurance company, you can get better deals for your insurance. If you are wearing a smartwatch and you behave responsibly, that is, you don't fool around during the night, you have 8 hours sleep, Then you exercise in the morning and you have, let's say, a life without big ruptures, then it can be observed on the smartwatch. So essentially what we are talking about right now, now let us come back to the general perspective of the data protection. We know that we generate data. Every little move we make when we buy things from internet is the data, is the signal. And we would like to know who is collecting this signal, what kind of decisions are made with this signal, and what we are getting in return for that. Okay, in this case, well, it was a positive interaction between private business in the US and in Europe and statistical thinking. Let me move on to the second example. I like examples from the health industry, well, because I'm already more than 60 and I know very well what disease means to a person. And of course, most of the participants, I think, of today's webinar, at least once in your lifetime, you had the electrocardiogram done, okay? In a traditional analog world, the electrocardiogram, well, essentially you record the heartbeats and then the specialist is looking at the graph and saying, oh, this looks like normal. Or the other specialist is saying, no, maybe it's not normal. Maybe you have some disease. We can automatize this process. We can provide a tool with the artificial intelligence, with the big data, with the Internet of Things and the statistical procedures. We can provide a tool to doctors to monitor not only one patient, not only people who are in a very moment connected to electrocardiogram, but to monitor other patients, okay? So in order to do that, let me give you very, very quick, basic look at the electrocardiogram. The electrogram is like a curve. It is actually monitoring the heartbeats. So now we are not monitoring the person running, but we are monitoring the heart beating. And we have five elements of this curve, the P, the Q, the R, the S and T. And the way they look is essentially related to some diseases of the heart. And let me be a little bit more precise. We are going to analyze now with the advanced statistical software, the PQRST curves, in other words, the electrocardiogram curves of the normal person versus a person who has the premature ventricular contraction, the PVC for short. The PVC, well, I don't, I'm also not a medical doctor. I cannot claim I know everything about PVC. I just know it's a very serious disease when you have ventricles that are contracting too early, your heart is definitely malfunctioning. And it is a very common disease, for example, among children, and early diagnosis and then some therapy can help actually providing a cure and monitoring the patient. On this picture, with the we have a bunch of black lines. The black lines correspond to the PQRST of a normal person, and the gray lines correspond to the person that is sick, that has this premature ventricular contraction syndrome. Okay. We definitely see some differences. Of course, we, you know, now when we sit comfortably, when we look at the pictures done for many patients, those curves represent 30 patients that are normal and 30 patients that are PVC. So of course we can visually say the gray curves look different and it will be easy to tell the difference. But now what our eye is doing, how to tell the machine to tell the difference between the normal looking curve and the abnormal curve. What kind of features and characteristics we'll be using? Let us have a better look at the feature curves of a normal person and the feature curves of the PVC person, okay? Well, what we are doing? Now I'm, well, entering a modern statistics and the research we are right now doing. But this research I can also present to students in the classroom. Why? Because I'm not sure what kind of a data processing package you are using in your statistics class. I belong to the R community, which is actually worldwide. It is the open source program. You don't have to pay a penny in order to download it to your computer. However, you have to know a little bit of statistics. If you don't, there are PDF files accompanying the R package explaining every little bit of the analysis. What this analysis has done to the electrocardiogram curves, to the PQRST curves. We see a matrix of graphs. Okay, we see a matrix 4x4, and on the diagonal, using a new statistical method, which theoretically is very advanced because it's based on the advanced mathematics of Hilbert space, we are decomposing the curves into forming elements. You know, in the previous, let's say, 150 or 200 years ago, the approximation, mostly in mathematics, was done with the Fourier series, which means you have a fixed base of functions which are not dependent on data, and on the basis of this function, it approximates what you observe. These days, we are doing differently. We say, okay, we will have a set of functions that are driven by the data, and those basic functions you see on the diagonal of this matrix. Beyond the diagonal, you see lots of points. And those points are scores that measure the quality of the approximation. So we have an advanced tool to do the data analysis. Those pictures beyond the main diagonal represent the quality of the approximation. The more random is the cloud, the better is the approximation. So approximation is not yet ideal, but it looks not too bad. We can measure the randomness, for example, by the correlation coefficients, okay? So now look, with this functional data analysis tool that is available in the R package, it was developed by our Spanish colleagues in Santiago de Compostela, a very famous town in Spain. What are you doing? You are doing, first of all, data compression. You don't have to, because electrocardiogram is also collected with the frequency of, let's say, 2 kHz. If you observe 30 people for 10 minutes each, you have already millions of data. Instead of having millions of data, you have 4 functions and the numbers that correspond to those functions. We call those functions eigenfunctions. And we also have, there is a printout from the R that actually is telling us the number. So to those of you who don't like curves, we can tell the difference because the first set of calculation that you see corresponds to the normal person, and you have the eigenvalues between 71 to 14, 11, 5, okay? And for the sick person, you have totally different eigenvalues. So now we have arrived at a certain feature and the test. Comparing those eigenvalues and the eigenfunctions, you can tell the machine, okay, give a signal to a doctor, patient who is having the large eigenvalues is probably prone to the premature ventricular contraction. Those who don't have such high eigenvalues, well, probably they are not yet sick. So I'm not claiming that this system will replace the doctor, but this system enables us to monitor many patients at the same time and facilitate, well, you know, the public health monitoring, okay? We do the data compression, therefore, and again, the question is, who is going to manage the data? That's why health data, besides, let's say, the national ID data, tax data, work data, the health data are, this is the area that is extremely sensitive to any country and has to be well managed, okay? Another example. Well, if you are bored talking about the health, let's talk about the cars, okay? Car is, of course, also producing signals, you know? Most of us, well, I drive the car for almost 40 years, and I think I have a good musical ear. So simply if I start the car, I can listen whether the car works more or less properly or it has hiccups. So when the motor doesn't work evenly, it has hiccups, the extremes on the signal, it may actually tell us the trouble. But we need to be a little bit more precise, okay? We are doing part of my research and also done with my students from Algeria, Tunisia, and Mali, and with my collaborators from Tunisia, is based on the family of signals that we call cyclostationary signals. So we have a model. And again, we have features that I was talking about earlier, frequencies, and we can decompose such a signal into frequencies. And we can characterize the, well, properly working gene or not properly working gene with just few frequencies, which is, again, data compression, big saving of time, and a possibility of making decisions online, okay? When we are collecting data on motors, we have the 5 kHz frequency. So if you have 10 sensors in one motor, which doesn't seem these days to be exaggerated, so in 1 hour, 10 sensors producing 5 kHz each data produces 180 million of observations. And you need to make a decision. You need to make a good car diagnostics based on that, which means you need to have good artificial intelligence and statistical algorithm. And again, this fundamental change in our civilization, which is occurring right now, although, of course, we know that we are in a big trouble in terms of pandemic, but on the other hand, this pandemia has even accelerated the introduction of digital media. Probably, if that wasn't pandemic, I'm not sure whether you will be having a webinar with speakers from all around the world, as I know. I'm also invited to, just a week ago, I had a talk with Universidad de Colombia in Bogota. So, you know, the digital world that is developing in front of our eyes is creating a completely new environment also for teaching data analysis. I was personally involved in creating a data science program at Politechnika Krakowska. I have personally also created a department. I call this department AIDA. Well, to those of you who love opera, I don't have to tell you what AIDA means. But AIDA is the acronym for Artificial Intelligence and Data Analysis. I have created this department within NASC, within this National Institute for Cybersecurity. And we are providing tools to public sector to analyze massive data. I don't want, since maybe I have only, 10 or a little bit more than 10 minutes left, I'm not going to tell you about this right now. Let me show you back to the statistical, let's say, analysis room, how we analyze data signals from those sensors from engine. Now we have a matrix of pictures, which is 6x6. On the main diagonal, you have the eigenfunctions, that is the data-driven functions that can actually reconstruct the signal. Beyond the diagonal, you have the measure of accuracy of the approximation measured by the correlation coefficient. The closer the correlation coefficient is to zero, the better it is for the model. So we are actually very happy to have this type of approach. And now imagine a fast train. We are only in the last few years having some fast trains in Poland. For example, Kraków and Warsaw, two major cities in Poland, are separated by 300 kilometers. And we have a train that is covering this distance in about 2 hours. Maybe not such a big accomplishment. Recently, well, before COVID, I was visiting France, where the TGV train is covering the distance from Paris to Marseille, which is 800 kilometers, in about 3 hours. And on those trains, so far, French railway system, the Société Nationale des Chemins de Fer, they operate the fast trains for last 40 years already. And so far, God forbid, nothing really bad happened. The worst accidents on TGV in France was when the wheels started to burn. They needed to stop the train and evacuate the passenger. No one was hurt, but the connection between major cities was blocked for a day, which was the major inconvenience. So what is happening right now? Right now, you have hundreds of sensors working online, sending you the signal about the well-being of wheels, and then you can monitor the quality and do the replacement when it is needed, not after some fixed time policy. So it's another application of statistics to big data and mechanical monitoring problems. Okay, so let me finish my talk with very general comments. I gave you examples from health industry, from, let's say, engineering research, how we now have to work with massive data sets, with the Internet of Things and the artificial intelligence, okay? Now let us look realistically at three models that are developed in this sector, where the artificial intelligence world is leading. What are really the main vectors of development in AI? From my own perspective, I can identify the three main models. The first is the European Union, where we are very careful about data sharing policies. On one hand, of course, we are all for open data, but on the other hand, we are insisting on all companies to show how they use the data. And this legal framework has the acronym GDPR. This is the data protection regulation. In United States, only California these days is introducing an equivalent of GDPR, but otherwise we have the GAFA, the Google, the Apple, the Facebook, and the Amazon, who provide, of course, excellent tools. Very few European companies can actually compete with American-based companies in the area of providing tools. But on the other hand, we don't know that it's not very transparent in the United States environment what kind of data processing system is used and who is really profiting from the access to data. Whenever you are logging into computer in Europe, I have a friend who used to be an ambassador of the United States in Poland, and when he was coming to Poland, he was trying to check his email. He saw many signs, because when you are in Europe, when you are checking into internet, when any company is trying to install a cookie on your computer, by law, it has to be an information, whether you agree with that or not. In the US, it is not the case, not necessarily the case. So we have a second model, the private corporation. I'm not necessarily saying that the second model is bad. I'm just saying that maybe it needs to be more transparent. And unfortunately, we have the third model, which is the Chinese model. And of course, we know that China is one of the leaders in the digital revolution. Of course, it goes without saying. And there is the huge conglomerate Huawei, who is also trying to be present in many telecommunication, 5G, IoT types of initiatives. Unfortunately, it comes with the risk sometimes. I'm not trying to sort of black paint Huawei altogether. It's a very fascinating advanced company. Recently, I was invited to do the online tour of Huawei enterprise premises in Shenzhen in China. But you have to be aware that when you are working with Huawei, and if you don't have a very top knowledge of controlling how your data are managed, you can end up actually in having part of your data analyzed not necessarily on your servers, but on the servers with the extension CN. Okay, so in all this business of working with the data, Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, what are the problems for all countries, for all societies? We have to be careful of digital sovereignty. Again, my claim is that now data is as important as real estate. How you protect your real estate? You have your claim in court. You have all the documents saying that this, let's say, land or this house is yours. How you can claim your property of the data? That's a very good question. The question that is still largely unresolved. Second, as citizens of developing and developed countries, we need to insist on transparency of digital value chains. What is the digital value chain? From the data to the decisions. I have shown you today three examples of a digital value chain for a runner, for the person with the premature ventricular contraction, and for the car motor, right? We need to create systems or reconstruct our democracies and create new political mandate for the data governance, okay? Well, we are sometimes mocking European Union because through regulations, they say that they even control the curvature of the banana. It's as strict in European Union. But I, as a statistician, I'm happy that I live and work in European Union because, well, we have this clear program of data transparency. I will be very much looking forward to questions and your comments, how the data policy is actually resolved in Oman. Now, from the national interest perspective, the digital revolution, of course, has immense impact. For example, in public administration in Poland, I was one of the key people who has implemented the system to process the data. In Poland, for 38 million population, we have over 2 million people working for government, the central government and the local governments. And every person working for government, of course, is doing, well, data processing, well, document analysis. With the artificial intelligence, we are able these days to create programs that can help, for example, classify documents into certain sectors in automatic way. Education, of course, I told you so much about the artificial intelligence in statistics, but I mean, any class with the system that in the Ministry of Digital Affairs in Poland and NASK in particular was developing, the artificial intelligence can enter the history class or the language classes with the big data. Let me give you some, I'm getting close to finish my talk, and let me give you some very specific examples. NASK and the Ministry of Digital Affairs has recently produced a national ID that you can download to your smartphone. It is not only a, let's say, it is definitely not a big deal to do the photocopy of your national ID, but this is not the point. This is the interactive ID. For example, these days when we are limited with our mobility, it is not advised to leave your home because there is this pandemic. You can do many things beyond banking transaction. You can, for example, have a deal and sign it electronically using your nationwide ID installed on your smartphone. So that's an opportunity to replace the need of physical meeting. When you have a deal and you need to sign a financial agreement, you can do it in a digital way using the very secure and safe application of the national ID in Poland. Another example that I was very heavily involved in is the project of connecting 26,000 elementary and secondary schools in Poland. On the right-hand side, what you see is Poland. We are from the south, our boundary is touching high mountains Tatra. From the north, there is the Baltic Sea. We have also Russia, this stretch of the border, Belarus and Ukraine on our eastern border, Slovak and Czech Republic from the south and Germany from the west. We are building special network of symmetric internet. So, of course, it is not a big deal for a school to have a private provider providing the internet. But if you want in all 25,000 schools to have a same lesson of history, organizing, for example, a digital visit of Museum of Warsaw, no private provider will be able to provide such a connection. If you have a fiber optic network installed connecting those schools, it is possible. So that's the opportunity for fast data flow. I'm coming now to the conclusions of my talk. I think that the digital revolution that we are passing through right now should have a significant impact on the way we teach data science and statistics. I should say the following. Whenever I'm starting my statistics class, I'm asking students, hey guys, how many of you know exactly what is the electronic fuel injection into the combustion chamber of your car, of the motor of your car? Very few people know. And then how many of you have driver's license? Well, mostly everyone has a driver's license. So you can operate a car and not necessarily know the technical details how the car engine operates. Okay, if you would like to be a car mechanic or an engineer, of course you should know. But if you are just a user, you don't have to know. So in my opinion, data science programs and statistics programs should be introduced as early as it is possible to students in secondary schools, where any person having contact with data, being let's say 15, 16 already, there is no problem in showing tools and showing what do those tools do. And then if you mature, if you go to the master level in data science, then of course you can explain in more detail in the technical way. Because data science and statistics will be the leading topic. From my experience until, let's say, COVID pandemic, every summer I was teaching a class of statistics within University of California. In data science program in University of California, Berkeley is so popular that they had to rent a movie and able to take 500 students at once to have a teacher teaching the data science. And you know, graduates of just bachelor program in United States, bachelor degree has 4 years. So the normal age of a graduate with bachelor degree is about 23, 24. Those guys are getting median salary per year is about $100,000 per year. Such a salary is paid to university professor at University of California with at least 10 to 12 years experience in data science. It's a hot topic also in Poland. When I was leading the NASK institution and I was creating this the department AIDA I told you about, artificial intelligence and data analysis, in order to hire a data scientist with maybe 5 years experience, you needed to pay the salary equivalent to the senior specialist. It's an extremely hot topic. We don't have enough people who know how to do it. That's why we need to do training and once more training. Again, what seemed to be yesterday, a very esoteric theory, where the Hilbert space-based approximation theory, now it is the practice of data analysis. I gave you examples of this matrix with functions and features characterizing the signal, okay? There is a danger for countries that are developing. If you don't have good data science programs, if you don't have the personnel that is able to give you some insight and understanding what is practically the meaning of data sovereignty, it means you will be losing your data sovereignty. It means you will not be able to control the flow of your data. Check your data. It is important as your real estate. Welcome to the modern world of the digital platforms. I will be definitely extremely pleased to answer your possible questions and comments. I'm leaving here with my email, and I understand now I would like to thank you with this little teddy bear. And I think I should now close the screen sharing, right? Because that's the end of my presentation. Should I close the screen sharing or should I keep it on?
You can close.
Okay, so I'm closing the screen sharing.
Okay, thank you, Dr. For your presentation. We have a lot of questions here on the question. I can see that you answer this. I don't know, do you read this or not? I don't think so that you can read this question, but a lot of this.
I was giving a talk. When I give a talk, I don't read anything. I am focusing on my audience. So now, should I read those questions or could you do me a favor?
I just read this question for you, that the one of this interesting question: what is the role of open data and achieving transparency of the data value chain? And is there a limit to what data should be opened?
Okay, very, very good question. I like the question about the data chain and the open data. As a statistician, of course, I would like to have, let's say, non-essential data. What are the essential data? I don't want, for example, I don't like the idea, for example, that Google is managing my calendar. If possible, I'm avoiding this because I'm the master of my own day and I don't want some remote company to manage my day and of course know what I'm doing during the day. But it is a very personal question. We need governments. We need international agreements on what is the let's say essential data that needs to be protected. Let me give you an example. I think health industry is a very, very good example. Because on one hand, we probably don't want to share with everyone what kind of sickness we had. It's our private secret. On the other hand, our disease, all the information related to that can be very helpful in diagnostic systems. So we need to very carefully actually split the personal part of the health data and the, let's say, observational part. When I'm as a statistician, when I'm analyzing the electrocardiogram, I'm not interested who was the person on which the PQRST signal was measured. This is none of my business. My business is to introduce some methods that will facilitate doing the diagnosis. So in health industry, very carefully protecting the first and last name and making sure that anyone accessing the data set will only see the data, not the real person, would be very, very helpful. But there is a, let me give you an example how tricky the data protection system is. Well, for example, usually I'm giving this example in Poland when the first name like Pan Jacek is somewhat popular, but not very popular. I'm sure that in Oman, probably I'm the only Jacek right now in this whole webinar. So for example, if I will ask the question, what is the average salary of everyone? What is the average salary of people who attend right now the webinar? It is not a private question because, well, you can collect the data in an anonymous way. You calculate average salary and you give a number, okay? And then if I ask a second question, what is the average salary of the webinar participants whose first name is not Jacek? This second information also seems to be very anonymous. You are not divulging any secrets. But if you take the average salary of everyone now in the webinar and deduct the average salary of all people whose not first name is Jacek, you will know exactly how much I'm making, which of course, well, I'm not a millionaire. If I were, I wouldn't be here probably, but it's my private information. So it's a tricky business. There is still lots of research done both in European Union and the United States. A year ago, I was invited to a conference in Georgia when there is a huge cybersecurity center created with the help of Army and the state of Georgia, in Augusta, Georgia. Those of you who play golf may know that the famous golf tournaments every year are organized in Augusta, Georgia. That was the site of the conference. And we were asking the question, what mathematical models that are able to do the automatic kind of chopping between what is private, what is public, should be installed? It is a tricky question. I gave an example. So there is no unique answer to the question, what should be private, what should be public. As a citizen of the democratic country and as a statistician, of course, I'm all for opening the data. But hey, I don't want everyone to know how much I'm making or what kind of sicknesses I have had. That's for sure. So there should be a limit. That's why we need international organizations, and in the European Union, we do have organizations like ENISA in cybersecurity, and there are norms which are coded ISO, ISO norms, and there is a collection of norms, ISO 27000, related to data security and cybersecurity.
Thank you very much. Also, we have the question about the Internet of Things. What do you think the Internet of Things can completely replace the human mind and take its own decisions?
Hopefully not. Let me tell you this. Of course, it's an extremely popular question whether we humans will be replaced by intelligent machines. Let me tell you this. In Europe, we have seen much worse than that. In Europe, just in generation of my parents, I was lucky not to see that, we saw two terrible wars. Humans against humans. And the terrible systems like Nazi system and the communist system liquidating millions of people. It is calculated right now that communism in Soviet Union, Central Europe, Cambodia, China has eliminated 100 millions of human beings, and German Nazi system has eliminated about 30 million of people. Population of Poland was reduced by 20% only in 5 years of the Second World War. Many people have died in concentration camps in Siberia. Our towns, Warsaw, Poland was totally demolished, and we needed to put a lot of resources to rebuild the country. So I think we have seen much worse than the intelligent machines replacing humans. We saw humans killing other humans. So this is the main thing. Of course, what every country, what every group of specialists, what even every family needs to know is how to deal with devices. Well, of course, at my side, I have this device, which is a smartphone. This smartphone is an extremely helpful device, but also it can, you know, it can has tremendously negative effect of, for example, teenagers. If you cannot separate yourself from smartphone, if instead of having a healthy, normal life with jogging, walking, reading books, you do nothing but interact with your smartphone. So, you know, this device can be either a source of beautiful advancement of the human mind, when I need, for example, a quick translation on what I'm reading book, of course, I open my smartphone, I can Google up many things, and I'm extremely happy. But if I do nothing but data processing by smartphone or emails, well, you know, we need to introduce good levels of, let's say, usage of artificial intelligence tools. We need to know at what level we would like to get involved with artificial intelligence. That's why I personally, again, I don't like Google putting information into my personal agenda for a day. I am writing in my calendar and not the Google.
I think that's very close. I just watched The Social Dilemma. I don't know, did you watch this film? Exactly about this problem, the networking and big data and collecting this big data by the Google, Amazon and so on. And in real life, we have the situation that because the Google is not like the company, it's like the 100 person who decide what we want to see, what we want to read, what we want to buy. Yeah, and just this 100 people decide everything, because we cannot speak that the computer decides this. The person, this guy provides this information for us. It depends who will have this power that they can manage this. They can create something good or something bad, depend on the situation.
You are absolutely right, because, you know, Google is a private company. We are not voting for someone to become a chair of Google. We have governments. So I think the decision on which tools have to be used, of course, governments will never produce software. It's not the role of your government. But the governments in Poland, we have the Ministry of Digital Affairs, right now directly under the Prime Minister of Poland. Such ministry has to oversee and check and provide, let's say, the testing platforms for all the tools that are introduced, with the aim of the well-being of the society. Exactly. That's the problem of digital sovereignty, that I call it. We need to regain our sovereignty. Again, I'm not against Google. I use Google many, many times per day. It's a fascinating company providing quick links to whatever information I need. Fantastic. I cannot do my research these days without Google, without other browsers, without Web of Science, without Scopus, without emails from my friends and all this. So, of course, I'm an internet junkie, I can say this. But on the other hand, I need time to focus. I need time to read calmly the literature. And so there should be some shield separating, let's say, all this buzz with the information and our own well-being. And one comment of a person who is now elderly, I'm now almost 61. Information, let us not confuse information with the wisdom. You can have lots of information and you may have no knowledge whatsoever, okay? And on the other hand, you may have excellent knowledge and you may not necessarily know all the little tricks. So We have to be careful, especially our organization, the public organizations should have the mandate to control the private corporations. Again, I'm not against private corporations. I like the case of European Union against Google. The case was in the court, I think, more than a year ago, because Google has refused to share data regarding the marketing tools they use in order to gather information about, you know what customer profiling is. When you do shopping over internet, you are automatically profiled. So the one day, let's say you buy one soap, the next day there will be a commercial of soap coming automatically to your email or to your browser. This is customer profiling. And Google has refused to share the data because in order to do customer profiling, you need to be able to collect millions of data and do automatic classification. And Google has refused to do that. European Union has started the case because this lack of cooperation with data sharing meant disadvantage to small companies who are also trying to sell something on the internet. Google, as the giant, has a big advantage, actually unfair advantage, over small companies in terms of customer profiling. They refuse to do that, and hey, they already paid a fine over 1 billion, 1 times 10 to power 9 euros. And that's the way to go. It's not to eliminate Googles. We love Googles. We all use it. Just we would like to know where is this data transparency. If the Google calls for data transparency, beautiful. Well, let's also ask Google to share with us the Google's data. This is the data transparency. This way we are coming back to the program. I can give you another example. Public administration is also at danger, at risk, because we are passing now through this digital revolution. And I remember as a director of NASK, I was participating in a conference in a relatively big town of Poland, where the officials from the city government were proudly presenting the way they have digitized their offices. And of course, what they meant to introduce digital platform, it really meant to introduce Microsoft Office and the Microsoft Excel. And on the top of it, there were two representatives of the Microsoft Office company in Poland who were advising during the presentation those city officials what are the elements of the digital affairs. What this means that, you know, you are in the hands of only one provider of the software. I know that probably 99% of people who do word processing, they are using Microsoft Word. I have nothing against Microsoft Word, but I'm asking a question, why we should pay for that? Why Microsoft Word or Microsoft Excel isn't just an open product like R, the platform for doing statistical calculation? As a scientist, when I prepare my papers, I'm not using Microsoft Word because it's not flexible enough. I'm using LaTeX. And LaTeX is a public domain program, which is completely free. And you can learn how to run this program. It's not as user-friendly as Microsoft Word, but no, it is free. So that's another question. Who is taking advantage? Do we have the monopoly of providers of software? Or we would like to have the word that is demonopolized. We would like to have many providers, maybe on one platform. Those questions are still ahead of us. Yeah. On the top of it, our communicator we are using right now is the Microsoft Teams. So maybe Microsoft will not be seeking revenge against me and closing immediately the communicator.
Yeah, but the last this pandemic and last 6 months, last 8 months, we have dramatically changes. And I see, for example, that I come to Amman, we have the classes in the econometrics and we count everything manually. And during this 3 years, the situation changed. And now, for example, students in college use not on just only the Excel, but also SPSS, and they must do this. It means right. Now, we don't have any option, another option like this study and use this internet connection and all this application. And for example, it's much more easy use this in the real life and the teaching process. For example, I have the smartwatch, as you yes. tell, and I do not know how can I live without the smartwatch before, because they show me the heart rate and everything, and I know the all information here about the all messages. That's why also I read this one question for you about this scale of the use of Internet of Things device in contemporary times. What do you think?
Could you repeat the question, because there's a little breach in connection? Could you repeat the question?
Okay. What is the scale of use of Internet of Things devices in contemporary times?
Well, that's another very good question. I will translate this question into the question of using 5G, because Internet of Things is very, very broad. 5G is this digital platform that is able to connect things and make, let's say, machines talk using the internet. It is the 5G. With 4G, it's very, very difficult. So, for example, in Poland, which is a relatively advanced country, we are maybe not as advanced as Germany or United States, but, you know, in terms of telecommunication, we are not too bad. The coverage, I mean, in order to have Internet of Things, you need to have 5G. In order to have 5G, you need to have coverage. How you are going to realize this coverage? Well, you need radio, that is, you need antenna, and you also need a cable, because radio is much slower than a cable, okay? Before starting to work at NASC, where I met many specialists from telecommunication, I was thinking very naively that when I talk either with Oman or with United States, it is through satellites. Not true. There is a cable connecting Europe and United States, which transmits the signal much faster. 1 millisecond delay is the minimal delay you get when you use satellite with transmitting the signal. So 5G, you know, 1 millisecond delay when you drive a car, when let's say a car is driving itself of the speed of 100 or 120 kilometers per hour, it is a significant chunk of time. So you need to have infrastructure of fiber optics in the country and the radio antenna. Well, now talking about radio antenna. In big cities, of course, there are skyscrapers, buildings, you can put those antennas. But out there, outside the big cities area, well, the local governments are not so very happy to see new antennas. There were many cases in Poland of people who are against 5G, and they were destroying the antennas already created for the 5G purposes. I'm not sure about Oman, but in Poland there is a significant, maybe 5 to 10% of population of people who deny the existence of COVID, and who say that 5G with COVID is sort of a worldwide agreement of governments to introduce a totally totalitarian system. I mean, it's phony baloney, but people believe in that.
We told the tower 5G infect coronavirus only those people who believe that the earth is flat.
Yes. Well, but you know, what does it mean? Let us not laugh from people. I don't want to mock people. I would like rather to teach people. You know, what does it show us? That, you know, maybe a group of people like us in universities, we understand the development of technology, but the large portions of population are left without this knowledge. And then the natural reaction is fear. People fear new technologies if you don't explain, if you don't show the benefits of this new technology. In Poland, coming back to Internet of Things, in Poland, really, the 5G is at the very, very beginning. In Warsaw, some parts of the downtown Warsaw have the 5G coverage, and some big cities. We still even don't have 4G in some areas of Poland, let alone 5G. And again, access to information should be a fundamental right of the citizen of the democratic country. So if we are planning new systems that will automatically transmit information, like 5G, we need to think about this aspect, because if we don't think about it, we will create zones of digital exclusion, zones where people will have no access to modern internet, and then maybe in a natural way, they will think that we are doing something totally weird, and they will be against this new revolution. That's why, you know, it's a public problem. 5G and the Internet of Things has to be, first of all, very carefully explained and also very carefully implemented. And for this, you need ministries, you need public organizations, governments that will be checking. When we think about 5G in Poland, we have two major providers. There is a provider, Ericsson, who already has some technology with 5G. And of course, guess what? Another company is Huawei. Huawei, Chinese are big time in 5G. They have created already huge advances. And well, you know, I don't want, as a scientist, I know how many excellent scientists are in China. When I was teaching classes of statistics within the University of California, my best students' last names were either Zhang, Wang, or Li. Chinese students are brilliant. Those people have excellent preparation. They are hardworking. So I don't want to say China totally is a danger. Well, not true. But we just have to be very careful with organizations who may represent rather interests of the Chinese government, who would like to check what we are doing with our data, and not only provide the solutions.
Okay, we have a lot of questions, but I just want to ask you last one. What do you think the future holds for us the next 5 years?
Oh, for us teachers, well, you know, in next 5 years, I'm going to retire. So for me personally, it will be a retirement. But no, I'm of course, I'm joking. I think this is a fascinating time to be a teacher of such a topic as statistics. I wish I can be 20 years younger, because the next few years should bring, I mean, a dramatic change to the way we work with data. As you mentioned, that maybe 3 years ago in econometrics class, you were doing hand calculations, and now you have all the software. But this is just the beginning. The second step will be to understand what this, you know, excellent software can create in order to work with big data, because big data these days are everywhere. You have transactions on financial markets that happen with the frequency several transactions per second, and they are randomly separated, so they are not like signals evenly spaced in time. You observe patients, and you have those gigabytes of data just for one patient. So the curriculum in statistics and in computer science and statistics should go together to create a new area, which is data science. There is no data science without statistics, and there is no data science without computer science.
Okay, we already finished the more than 1.5 hour. That's why we have to finish, but we have a lot of questions here. We will publish this video, and I know that the people want to see, and maybe we organize some other meetings and the...
I'll be happy to continue interaction. And as I mentioned to you in the emails, maybe we can have, for example, one class that can be attended by both my students. I'm teaching right now. Every Tuesday, I have a class at 7:30 in the morning Polish time, which will be 9:30 your time, of statistics. We can have a half an hour with students both from Poland and Oman studying together, just for the fun of it, to share experiences, why not? And you know, this is the new sort of a look at the teaching, that our teaching initiatives are becoming so widespread that, there is no limit. There is no geographical limit to our activities.
Exactly. This is fantastic, because I can invite in my classes all my colleagues and friends around the world, and they just participate and describe some topics. It's impossible to do the in real life, because nobody can come on just only one visit. That's why we have right now a fantastic time to improve the knowledge, not only I, but the also student and the whole countries.
Yeah, okay, as a old time person, I should say that nothing would replace a real contact, human to human, but the digital contact nowadays is very high quality. So it is a good starting point.
Okay, we have to finish.
Yes.
I want to express my gratitude that you agreed to come, and I hope I will will see here again. Thank you for participating in today's webinar. We hope to see you again next time. Thank you, everybody.
See you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.